Is it a database software? An operating system? Well, it's both. Produced by Richard Pick, nicknamed Dick, yes I know, PickOS is older than SQL, Unix, or CPM. I've never seen anything like it, and the people who use it tend to love it to death. In today's video, we explore unique database software plus operating system. This video is brought to you by the Asianometry Patreon. So in 1965, the Army needed a data management system for a new project. This was the Vietnam War, and the Army was working with Lockheed on a new attack helicopter called the Cheyenne. They needed something to track the spare parts inventory. So they turned to a company called TRW in El Segundo, perhaps most well known, for leading the development of America's first ICBM. The Army's key two feature requests for their database software, at first given the rather drab name Parts Acquisition Data System, were 1. The retrieval language had to be in English and be user-friendly for non-programmers. And 2. The software had to be able to run on hardware that was yet to be determined. They eventually put it on an IBM System 360 mainframe, but the data it drew from was hosted on a variety of different hardwares. The first guy assigned to the job was a thoughtful, forward-thinking programmer named Don Nelson, not the basketball coach. Nelson was soon joined by an outgoing Berkeley MBA graduate named Richard Pick. The two produced a database software that they cheekily called Generalized Information Retrieval Language System, or GIRLS. The Army, however, had no sense of humor about such things and rechanged the name to Generalized Information Management, or GEM. As documented in a 1967 technical paper, GEM 1 feels ahead of its time. Its key feature was an Englishy prose-like query language, and this was achieved using data dictionaries through which domain experts can customize the database's vocabulary. Each query goes through the dictionaries, letting users write queries that are like, list the title, author, and abstract of every transportation system reference with the principal city Los Angeles and the ground effect machines AVC-1 or hovercraft. The dictionaries also allow GEM to be quite flexible. As needs crop up, you can add new items and attributes without affecting existing data. It reminds me of today's NoSQL databases like MongoDB, and indeed, I think they are a pioneer in that area. And as for the Army's hardware independence requirement, Nelson and Pick programmed GEM to run in a virtual software environment separate from whatever its hardware had. In other words, a virtual machine. TRW delivered the software in 1969 to some acclaim, but the larger project was in trouble. Lockheed struggled to deliver the Cheyenne helicopter, causing one fatal crash. With U.S. involvement in Vietnam winding down, the U.S. Army canceled the production contract in 1969. Unfortunately for TRW, they did not copyright or protect GEM. It's debatable, though, whether they could have, since it was funded with taxpayer dollars. Pick, anyway, believed that this released GIRLS/GEM into the public domain, so he took GEM and left TRW to start a business called Pick & Associates. After bouncing around a bit, Pick eventually licensed his code to a mini-computer company in Irvine, California called Microdata Corporation. Microdata used it for their new line of reality minicomputers in 1973. The business-oriented minicomputers were for typical business and accounting stuff, nothing too special except many users praised the computer's exceptionally strong file management software called English, all caps, which of course was the GEM database software. English uses the aforementioned dictionaries so that users can retrieve data using verbs, attributes, and selection criteria. One user said, "The biggest advantage is being able to use English. You can't beat it." In 1976, Pick left Microdata. The reason being that Pick wanted exclusive control of the OS and was seeking to port it to other hardware. The conflict boiled over when it was discovered that Pick had taken software with him out of the building. Microdata promptly sued Pick for stealing trade secrets, and the latter countersued. After a little dance, the two settled out of court in 1981 with shared custody. Microdata kept the Reality brand, and Pick had the rights to a Pick OS. Richard Pick at first wanted to sell his own hardware system. He even commissioned the French company Intertechnique to make boards for what he called the Evolution computer system. But selling that turned out to be too hard. So in 1980, he sold off the Evolution system to focus on licensing the OS to hardware makers. I believe Evolution became its own company. In a magazine interview, Dick said, "I sold Evolution because it doesn't seem to make much sense for us to be directly in the hardware business, since we license so many people on the software for them to sell the hardware. It is incongruous for us to be competing with licensees, so we made a decision to get completely out of the hardware and be the developers of the basic system." The first PicOS licensee was the computer company Honeywell, which put them in their Honeywell Ultimate system. The OS's good performance there led to more ports in the early 1980s. Since 95% of the PicOS needed no knowledge of its hardware, porting to new hardware was very easy. And as for microdata, they wasted a lot of time and money trying to develop a new OS to replace Reality. Running out of money, they sold themselves to the aerospace company McDonnell Douglas in 1979. The OS's core function was its database management software. Again, the key strength being an English-like query language, which Pick called Access rather than English because that trade name belonged to microdata. Pick had a unique file structure for data retrieval. Today's SQL-based relational databases keep their data in separate tables, so customers, orders, and order items information are stored in separate tables and related together using primary and secondary keys. PicOS, on the other hand, organized all of its information in layers, like the circles of hell in Dante's Inferno. The OS supports multiple user logins. Each user starts at the topmost system level layer, which then goes down to a layer of master dictionaries. The master dictionaries define verbs and commands for queries, and they also contain links to the next layer down, the data dictionaries. The data dictionaries point you to the PIC files themselves and define what information is in them: item, attribute, value, and subvalue. The whole database is very flexible, maybe too much so. For those more familiar with SQL, a PIC database management system can feel very different, dangerous, and maybe even a little naughty. For example, PIC had multi-value fields. In SQL, when a customer has three phone numbers, you put each of those numbers in a row in a separate phone number table. They can be linked to the customer via a foreign key. But in PicOS, if the customer has three phone numbers, it can store all three in one value field as a single line of ASCII text. The system uses a special character like a right square bracket or a comma to separate them. Yes, PIC fundamentally stores everything, dates, numbers, whatever, as ASCII text strings. If you want to add together two pieces of stored data, PIC converts them to numbers at runtime. Is that safe? Who knows? Any value checks, like those to prevent from inserting a word into a dollar field, have to be implemented by the programmer. That variable length text string can be as long or short as you want. Literally every record in a PIC instance can be different from one another. Finally, somewhat infamously, all dates in a PicOS system are stored in the form of days since past December 31st, 1967. Dick never gave a real reason why this was a case, but most presume it was because that was when the first PIC computer went online. To a SQL programmer, this all might sound odd. But there are countless instances of people who worked with PIC who loved its flexibility and sturdiness. While the query and report generator are the heart of the system, PicOS also included several built-in applications like a text editor, spreadsheet program, word processor, and terminal control language. Ask your great-grandparents, kids. PicOS even offered its own programming language, a variant of BASIC called PicBASIC. That let you write, compile, and run small applications. Some 2,000 to 3,000 packages were eventually made. Programmers, especially the hacker types, weren't too excited by the lack of language choice. PIC basically chose it in the late 1960s because there were no other suitable higher-level language options that managers and programmers were familiar with. But PicBasic's greatest value was its deep database integration. Programs can access any item or information inside a pic file, which at the time was somewhat unusual. An assistant treasurer and a major manufacturer marveled that the pic system removed any preconceived notions that programmers held about how data can be stored and manipulated. To quote him, quote, "it had no walls," end quote. Richard emphasized how his whole system was built around data management and framed most issues in the world as data management problems. I found this quote from a February 1987 interview kind of amusing. "The Star Wars program is, in its simplest form, a problem in data management. The government wants to know where all the Russian warheads are, give or take a few milliseconds." This focus on easy-to-use data management and report generation, as well as hardware independence, made PicOS systems a preferred choice for business and commercial users. It's interesting to contrast PicOS with the famous Bell Labs operating system, Unix. Unix was built as a developer's tool, with all the things that developers and hackers loved, like pipes and the C programming language. Unix fans love Unix. There might not have been as many Pic system fans, but they were just as fervent about their system. One writer said that to hear those people talk about discovering PicOS was like listening to born-again Christians speaking of their rebirth. One vendor said, "if the phone company owned the Pic system, there'd be no Unix." So if PicOS was so amazing, then why isn't it bigger today? Why do we remember Unix and MS-DOS, but not PicOS? Let us pick through a few reasons. One challenge that both Unix and PicOS faced was how to deal with its unruly ecosystem of integrators and distributors. In the early 1980s, Pic Systems' core customers were developers creating quote-unquote vertical applications, custom solutions for niche industries like funeral parlors or car dealerships. Since these licensees offered a complete solution, they sold PicOS under their own name. For example, Applied Digital Data Systems called it Mentor, General Automation called it Zebra, Ultimate Corp, the Ultimate System, and Cosmos marketed a version called the Revelation. Licensees had no incentive to tell people that they were using PicOS even as the base grew, and this eventually led to a Unix-like fragmentation where licensees for differentiation reasons started modifying the software for new features or specific new hardware. The rise of the IBM PC and the microcomputer should have been devastating for PicOS, since they were previously so dependent on minicomputers. But they were lucky. They had something PC users wanted. PC business owners wanted to let multiple employees log into the same computer and have their own sessions via connected monitors, like timesharing from back in the day. MS-DOS, however, was strictly single-user, opening the door for Pic as an environment to work on shared files. A former programmer at Pic Systems called Dennis Gallagher recalls porting the software and demonstrating how Pic let three users manage files with just a single PC. It astounded people. How can such a small and cheap computer be so capable? It probably had something to do with PicOS's virtual memory system, which let Pic access disk memory as if it were RAM. Later, more powerful CPUs allowed up to 16 people to share a single PC, which is wild. This became very popular and helped grow installations by 40% each year between 1982 and 1986, with accelerated growth after the PC port was introduced in 1984. By 1988, there were 130,000 Pic installations on mainframes and minicomputers, as well as 80,000 PC installs. Licensees would have loved to use this new Intel port, but Pic Systems stunned the community by withholding it for themselves and instead sold it directly to the public, putting the company in direct competition with its former customers. The conflicts between Pic Systems and its former licensees soured to the point of legal action. In December 1985, a Pic licensee called VMark announced a collaboration with AT&T to bridge Unix and Pic applications. The issue was that Pic Systems themselves were working on their own Unix collaboration with AT&T and sued VMark for copyright infringement and trade secret theft. These efforts greatly damaged the trust between Pic Systems and its community. As PIC entered the 1990s, reviewers started making references to the times having passed it by. Their estimated market share that year was just 3%. Even Unix had 31%. PIC struggled to move out of its B2B niche. The engineering and scientific spaces didn't need it because it lacked Unix's networking features, floating point performance, and mathematical functions. And as for the larger retail market, like I said, most people had never heard of PIC OS before, thanks to their prior white labeling business model. So when they started going direct, they were starting from scratch. And it's not like the former licensees were going to help them. There was also the issue of the user experience. PIC OS not having a graphics user interface meant that people navigated it via the command line. This was fine back in 1969, but unacceptable post-Macintosh. Not to mention that, in 1990, Microsoft would release the Windows 3.0 GUI, which became super popular. PIC Systems considered a partnership with a third party to make a GUI called GraphicalPIC, or GraphPIC, but that was nixed when the partners asked for a slice of every PIC OS license fee. So in the end, PIC became less of an OS and more of a standard database and productivity tool for business managers. The success of the PC integration led to another with Unix in 1989, putting the two once rivals side by side. To quote the introduction of an IDC white paper by PIC Systems, "In this day of hostile takeovers and faceless corporations, it is refreshing to come upon a privately held company still based on the vision of its founder. Indeed, 25 years after he converted his dream to reality, Dick PIC remains the guiding light behind PIC Systems. A lot of promising companies have come and gone in that time, but PIC persists." Yet one can also argue that Richard deserves some blame for some of the software's lack of direction and eventual fade. There's a fascinating 13-year-old Google Groups thread with a few former PIC Systems employees discussing why PIC OS never took off the way it should have. The leading post was by Jonathan Sisk, a former president of education at PIC. He wrote that Richard never wanted to be Bill Gates and take over the world, and once the company made enough to pay himself and his employees, he was content. He never took the company public, nor did he ally with a bigger company like IBM, so nobody could tell him what to do. And since he was the boss, people were afraid to tell him their actual thoughts, and just went along with whatever he said. So the company struggled with direction, especially in marketing, where it cycled through a bunch of VPs, including the famous Adam Osborne of Osborne Computer, who lasted a weekend. They spent a lot of money, but none of it had real impact. Dennis Gallagher, the aforementioned former programmer, recalled how Richard never respected the PC, calling it a toy computer despite the product being his company's top moneymaker, and at one point they stopped advertising it. I reckon that, like how it is with so many founders, Dick PIC's stubbornness was simultaneously his best asset and worst failing. Before we end, I want to thank viewers Bob and Paul for putting me onto this topic. Richard PIC tragically suffered a stroke in 1994 and passed away shortly thereafter at the young age of 56. He never set up a proper will, so PIC Systems passed into his estate and never regained its mojo after that. In 2000, they merged with Omnis Technology and became Reigning Data Corp. Reigning moved towards XML data management software and renamed themselves to Tiger Logic in 2008. 5 years later, Tiger Logic sells the PIC OS assets to a company called Rocket Software, a sort of roll-up holding company, I think, for these legacy products, and there it remains to this day. A lot of PIC instances have been replaced in recent years as NoSQL systems have gained popularity. But I reckon a few companies out there might still be running PIC. If you used it or programmed for it back in the day, feel free to share in a comment below. Alright everyone, that's it for tonight. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the channel, sign up for the Patreon, and I'll see you guys next time.